From Simon & Schuster Audio, Casino, Love and Honor in Las Vegas, by Nicholas Pileggi. Read by Joe Grifossi, Ron Leibman, Frederick Neumann, and Ken Weitzman.
I just had dinner, gotten in my car. I don't remember whether or not I turned on the ignition, but the next thing I saw were these little flames. They were only about 2 or 3 inches high. They were coming out of the defroster vents. I never heard any noise. I just saw the flames reflected against the windshield. And I remember, I asked myself, why is my car on fire? Then the flames started getting bigger. There must have been a strong enough jolt to throw me against the steering wheel because it hurt my ribs, but I don't remember any of that. All I thought was that my car was having some kind of mechanical problem. I didn't panic. I knew I had to get out of the car. I had to get away from the flames, call the garage, so I reached for the door handle. I almost torched my arm. There were flames shooting up between the seat and the door. Now I knew I had to get out of the car. I'd never see my kids again. This time I used my right hand to grab the door handle. I threw my shoulder against the door at the same time. It worked. I fell onto the ground. There were flames all around me. Some of my clothes were on fire. I was burning. I rolled around the ground till the flames were out. Two men helped me to my feet and got me about 20 or 30 feet from the car. They told me to get down, but I didn't want to. I kept saying I was all right. They insisted I get down. And when I did, it was as though the atom bomb had gone off. I saw my car jump about 2 feet into the air, and then flames shot up to the roof about 2 stories high. That's when I realized, for the first time, it hadn't been an accident. That's when I knew somebody put a bomb in my car.
Before his car was blown up outside Marie Callender's restaurant on East Sahara Avenue on October 4th, 1982, Frank Lefty Rosenthal had been one of the most powerful and controversial men in Las Vegas. He was in charge of the largest casino operation in Nevada. He was famous for being the man who had brought sportsbook betting to Vegas, an achievement that made him a true visionary in the annals of local history. He was a gambler's gambler, the man who set the odds, a perfectionist who had once astonished the kitchen help in the Stardust Hotel by insisting that every blueberry muffin had to have at least 10 blueberries in it. But Frank Rosenthal had been dodging trouble most of his life. He was a runner, clerk, and bookie for Chicago gamblers and mobsters before he was old enough to vote. In fact, before going to work inside the casinos in 1971, Lefty had held only one legitimate job, as a military policeman in Korea between 1956 and 1958. Frank Rosenthal came to Las Vegas in 1968 for the same reason so many other Americans have, to get away from his past. It was also the city where you could strike it rich, a kind of money-happy Lourdes where pilgrims got to hang up their psychic crutches and start life anew. Casinos mean cash. From the nickel slots to the $500 progressive super slots, cash is the blood that enlivens everything and everyone in a casino. The buildings are nothing but a cacophony of money. From the noisy geysers of a winner's silver change tumbling into the purposely hollow metal trays to the bells and buzzers and lights announcing minute-by-minute wins, cash dominates the room. Normal business techniques of fiduciary responsibility and cash accountability crumble under the mountains of paper money and silver coins that pour into casinos every day. There is probably no type of business in the world where as much paper money is handled on a daily basis by more people under more security than in a casino. Dealers have to clap their hands under the eye before leaving the table to make sure they're not carrying any chips away with them. The small aprons they wear are to cover their pockets and keep them from filling them. Every $100 bill changed for chips at the table must be called out by the dealer so the pit boss can watch it being slid into the narrow drop box slot with a metal paddle. No matter how busy a craps or roulette table might be, the chips must be evenly stacked by color to facilitate the almost continuous counting by supervisors. Blackjack dealers have to learn to cup the deck against side readers to make sure players in cahoots aren't swapping paints or face cards to beat the house. An experienced stickman at a craps table is trained never to take his eyes off the dice. Trying to beat the casino, through a miraculous win or alternatively through the more reliable methods of being a crook, is what brings everyone to town. In Las Vegas, beating the casino by hook or crook has been raised to an art form. But, of course, the greatest amount of casino theft has nothing to do with cheating players or crooked dealers. Most of the major theft in a casino doesn't even happen on the casino floor. The largest amount of larceny takes place behind closed doors in the casino's sanctum sanctorum, the casino's most sensitive and security-conscious area, the place where all of the cash, churning its way through the hundreds of games and slot machines, ultimately heads the casino's sacred count rooms. Usually, it is a windowless, double-locked, bare-bones workroom with straight-back secretarial chairs, clear plastic tables, and reinforced steel shelves and floors to bear the tons of coins and stacks of cash that must be counted daily. The count room is the place where the hundreds of double-locked metal boxes under every table game are emptied. Then their contents of $10, $20, and $100 bills are sorted into inch-thick $10,000 bricks and on busy days stacked against the walls chest-high. There are no strangers stealing this money in the count room. The money is taken in spite of the fact that cameras are often in use, that guards check everyone walking in and out, that only a very limited number of people can even enter. State law bars even casino owners, and that every dollar counted out of every single drop box on every shift must be signed and initialed by at least two or three independent clerks and supervisors. Count room workers go about their tasks with the deadened glaze of people who must steel themselves against the dazzling daily experience of being immersed in the sight, smell, and touch of money. Tons of it. Stacks of it. Bundles of cash and boxes of coins so heavy that hydraulic lifts must be used to move the tonnage of loot around the count room. There is such a daily fortune of stacked paper bills pouring into the count room that rather than being counted, the cash is assembled into various denominations and weighed. The dream for many of those who find themselves owning casinos or even working in them is to figure out exactly how to separate the count room from its loot. Over the years, the methods employed have run from owners getting their hands on Dropbox keys to employees grabbing fists full of cash before the boxes are even counted. There are complicated methods of misdirected fill slips and maladjusted scales that weigh only one-third of the loot coming through the count room doors. The systems for skimming casinos are as varied as the genius of the men doing the skimming. In 1974, only 6 years after arriving in Las Vegas, Frank Rosenthal had managed to get from Las Vegas exactly what he'd hoped, a new life. He was running four Las Vegas casinos. He had married a gorgeous former showgirl named Jerry McGee, and they lived with their two children in a $1 million house facing the 14th tee on the Las Vegas Country Club golf course. He had a swimming pool and a housekeeper. His bedroom closet had over 200 pairs of custom-made silk cotton and linen slacks, most of them in pastel shades, which he had specially fitted by tailors flown in from Beverly Hills and Chicago. He was the man to see at the Stardust, and his reputation as an innovative and successful casino manager was soon to be recognized throughout Nevada. He saw himself as a part of an elite group of casino impresarios, union pension fund officials, investment bankers, and Nevada politicians who were about to transform Las Vegas from its cowboy and gangster roots into the family-oriented $30 billion-a-year adult theme park it would eventually become. But 10 years later, Frank Rosenthal was under investigation as the mob's casino man in town and the suspected mastermind behind a multi-million dollar skimming operation. He had been denied a gambling license and was hosting an inadvertently hilarious 90-minute talk show, which he had modestly named the Frank Rosenthal Show. He was suspected of working in cahoots with his boyhood friend Anthony Tony the Ant Spilotro, who the FBI said was the Chicago mob's main muscle in town, a hitman suspected of at least a dozen homicides.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.